Hey everyone, I am back with yet another vlog. This time it's about the process leading up to the Powermetal Piano livestream that me and my good friend Mass did together with Kasper Top of Top Music a little while ago. Baby, baby, tell me more of your lies. I plan to do two vlogs on this topic. This one is about the process on picking out the songs, how to set up the format, and generally just how to get from idea to realization of doing this live stream that might inspire some of you to maybe do your own or give some ideas on how to avoid some of the pitfalls that I certainly fell in during this process. And the other vlog is going to be about memorization techniques. Because a thing that characterized this process a lot was time constraint and not having a million billion years to get everything super under your skin at a comfortable pace. Nah, it had to go fairly quickly, and for that you need efficient memorization techniques, and I'm going to share some of those I use for lyrics and melody, but that's for another vlog. Now, it all began when Kasper wrote to me sort of at random on Instagram asking if I wanted to be featured on his backyard live sessions, where he's doing these like little live streams from a super cute studio that he made in his backyard. And I was like, of course! And then my mind started racing a lot because, well, I'm not doing a show related to Ethereal Kingdoms, so I basically have 100% free reign of the creative expression because I'm not in the band context. What do I want to do? Like, okay, cool. I do a lot of classical stuff, but do I really want to do a 30-minute, like, arias and lead songs? No, I didn't want to do that. So, like, I have been listening to a lot of, like, super cheesy power metal lately, and I was just like, I want to do that. But he told me that the format was well-suited for something acoustic and, like, a duo. And a power metal duo wasn't really the thing, but power metal on piano, that sort of combined those two things, and I was like, heck yeah, I'm gonna do it. So I called up my good friend Mass and asked if he wanted to play the piano, and he was like, yeah, sure, let's go. Do you have shit music? And then I was like, no, I don't even have a set list. And that's when the process started, because we had a time constraint of roughly a month, give or take. We both had a lot of stuff going on in our life with school and projects and music and just living in general. And we had to do the show. So I started out by picking out some songs, this pool of like 10 songs, made a playlist. I was listening to it while just doing other stuff and being like, would this work? Because not every song is going to work when you transform it into another genre, which is basically what we did, bending it from a power metal arrangement into a piano and a vocal arrangement. And you have to sort of work your way around, do you need a secondary melody instrument? Do you need drums? Do you need something for this to work? Or will it function? I narrowed it down to a couple of songs. Then I went at it with a bit more of like realistic analytical glasses. Is it possible for us to learn this material in a short span of time with limited amount of rehearsals, and will it be fun? Because for me, the most important part of doing that live stream was having fun. It was supposed to be a fun live stream, and well, that narrowed it down even more. So we ended up having a set list of Sweet True Lies by Beast in Black, Dance Macabre by Ghost. I know, it's not strict power metal, but hear me out, I'll get to why later. We did House of Sleep by Amorphous. We did a version of one of Ethereal Kingdom's original songs called Heart Chamber. We did Straight to the Heart with Battle Beast, and we ended it, of course, on Nemo by Nightwish, because, you know, piano, yeah, you gotta have that one. So we have the set list. Well, now what? Mass asked for some sheet music or lead sheets, and I totally understand that, because when you have musical information written down, you can communicate a lot more efficiently, it's a lot easier to ingest it and learn the material, and, well, it just makes the entire process easier as you can communicate everything, like, let's take it from the break, oh, which chord is that? You can just play it. Now, the only song I could find that actually had sheet music for it was Nightwish. So what do? Well, I had to make my own. I transcribed it by listening to the chords and writing them down. Also, I cheated a little bit and looked up some tabs. That's allowed because, well, it's not a competition. And transcribing also helped me really get the songs under my skin, really learning them, because I understood by analyzing them, how long is each passage? How does the chord change? How is everything sort of structured? And when you learn something by heart, I'm going to go in depth with this topic in the other vlog that's coming later, but you have to know the structure. So that helped me a lot getting it done by simply transcribing everything. Then we went in for some rehearsals that were very condensed, very intense, but we got stuff done. And all of a sudden, I get this brilliant idea after talking to my good friend Anna, who also did the poster for the event. I'm gonna put a keytar into the mix! So, this is the Alesis Vortex MIDI controller. I have no idea how this thing works. Oh my god, it has tilt control! It means it has a little accelerometer or gyroscope built into it that apparently it will react to how you tilt it. I love this thing! Okay, I gotta find a better patch, but basically the setup I have going for me, I'm just gonna mess around with the camera here. Okay, I have the Alesis, which acts as a MIDI controller. Then I have a MIDI out signal going from the bottom of it here through the MIDI cable that goes into my sound card. And I'm sending a MIDI out, such as play a G. Oh my god, this sound is so bad! Into this, which converts the MIDI signal into something my computer can read. And then I just picked a virtual instrument in Logic, making sure that the channels are set to the same. You know, I'm gonna go all in with the 80s thing with the keytar, I still want it to sound nice. Now, it's a bit of a different experience playing the keytar, actually. I haven't ever played a keytar before in my life, so this is a lot of fun. Look at this, this is so cool, I love it so much. Adding an entirely new instrument that you've never played before to a format that's also new to you was maybe a bit of a bad idea with like 1.5 week notice, but we did it anyway because we picked songs that were comfortably within our skill levels, we picked songs that were fun, we picked out music that we really liked and that motivated us to play, and the setup was fairly easy. So I ended up playing some keytar solo in super 80s style over Dance Macabre by Ghost because I chose to be realistic. I wanted, I wanted to do like super fast keytar solos. I wanted to do that so bad. But I had to be realistic with my skill level that I don't know how to do that and I wouldn't be able to comfortably learn it within the time constraint. So I opted for something that was still fun and that was still nice to do and it still sounded nice but wasn't too complicated so it would still create a good experience for the listener because playing music is not about showing off how good you are at everything, it's about creating an experience for yourself, for those you play with and for those who watch. So I chose to go for sort of a Euro vibe and everybody thought it was fun, it at least seemed like it, that people who watch thought the keytar thing was a fun addition and I liked playing it as well and I'll probably play it more. It's oddly addictive. We also had to really think about what's the format of the show? Which audience is this intended for? So the audience itself became quite narrow because it was intended for people who like power metal, who like fun things. Those two usually go hand in hand. Power metal fans are generally quite happy people. And people who also like the vocal piano format, that narrows it down a bit more. People who are interested in live streams and people who are interested in hearing me sing and hearing mass play. So that narrowed it quite a bit down, but that didn't hurt it because that meant you could just focus more on doing your own things, really committing to, we want to make a fun show with these and these elements and just really focusing on making these kind of select people extremely happy watching this. And that was a really nice experience actually, trying to not appeal to everyone, but just appealing to those who were in the same sort of mental space as yourself. Now, then comes the evening of the show, and well, my day started out quite early. I usually get up very early to prepare for a show. I also have another vlog detailing how I sort of prepare myself for shows, and you can watch that if you would like some tips on how I do it. We showed up at Kasper's place in his backyard, and he has the nicest studio in the backyard. It's super cute. There are little chickens running around. There's a super cute dog, and it was just super warm and welcome atmosphere. he's really professional. He worked with some cool people, and he does just really good stuff. He really knows what he's doing, and I felt very, very safe. He's a fun guy. He's cool to hang with. So it was just a really good experience working with Kasper. And that microphone, whatever that thing was just literally golden. It was so good. Doing this as a live stream concert was a bit different from, of course, doing a regular concert with a seated audience that would look at you and cheer you on because you can't feel the energy of the audience. And afterwards, we saw people like commenting in the chat and being like happy with the song choices. But you don't see that when you're on stage. You just gotta get out there and make everything a little larger than life. But at the same time, it also creates a bit of a more intimate space, because it's just you and your musician buddy and whoever is doing the tech thing. And it's very intimate. And, well, just like a regular concert, you're going to have some stuff that doesn't go according to plan. And during one of the songs, Mass and I sort of musically disagreed on where we were. But this beautiful moment arose where we just kind of surrendered to the chaos that was happening. And it was basically felt like sort of a free jazz improvisation over this beautiful piece of music. And we totally changed the structure of everything, but it felt so good. That was a really magical moment. And I believe that was allowed to happen because of the relative less stressful environment being just three people in the room. It was very intimate. It was a very beautiful experience. And well, when I spoke to people who watched the show, they couldn't guess which song it was that kind of went a little exotic. So that's probably a good sign. I can reveal to you that House of Sleep, we sort of didn't agree on where we were, but it was just really nice, just actually improvising with each other and having that musical communication with each other. Now, that's possible because Maz and I have played together before and we kind of know each other and trust each other a lot as musicians, so that was nice. It was a good experience and I felt very safe and very comfortable doing it. Now, if you're doing a live stream concert, I have the following tips for you just to sum it up. Know the format. Who is your audience? Where are you playing? How are you playing? When are they going to watch it? And how long do you want to entertain them? I'd rather say a short and good show than a too long and sort of okay show. Short and sweet, because people are on their phones and they're like, their cat is knocking something over or, you know, getting distracted by stuff. So you want to keep it short and sweet. Another thing you could take into consideration is what is your limitations in regards to time? Picking out the repertoire, who do you want to entertain again? How long do you have to prepare it? And how much energy do you want to devote to this? And do you want to do something special and unique for the live stream? Like you could have done, I mean, we could have done some like interactive stuff like pick a song or make your fantasy set list, or you can do all sorts of things with live streams because it's a new format. And that's really exciting. And I hope to explore that sometime in the future. Another thing you need to do is the same things that you do when you're out at a real venue. Be a nice human, show up on time, and be good to the technician because he's the one making your show happen. So with that said, thank you so much for watching my vlog. There's going to be some videos from the shows probably coming to my channel. If you want to watch the Powermetal Piano livestream concert, you can head over to Kasper Top's channel. It's linked somewhere on the screen or in the box below where you can watch the show, the VOD from the show. Yeah, you should also totally subscribe to his channel because he's a cool guy and he deserves some more clout because he's super good producer. He's extremely humble, but he's just really good at what he does. So go tell him he's good at things today. Share the love, man. Also, if you want to check out Mass's band, go check out EXELERATE. They create high-octane power thrash here in Copenhagen, Denmark. And they're making a new album that I really look forward to hearing. My band is called Ethereal Kingdoms. You can check out a really cool poster back there. You can also check us out on the internet. There is some more links in the box. And until next time, I just want to say, wash your hands, stay safe, don't drink the sanitizer. But you know what I mean? Have fun, stay safe, go practice, and see you around.